So welcome back to Unit 4. So this virtual source model that we have developed for nanoscale MOSFETs, it really has two purposes. One is for us, it helps us develop a physical understanding of how these devices operate. The other reason it is useful is it provides us a way to analyze measured data from modern transistors and to extract some physically relevant parameters that help us tell what's going on inside that transistor. What I'd like to discuss in this lecture is just a very brief introduction to how we might analyze experimental data. So we're going to use our transmission model. You've seen that the linear regime current is related to something we've called an apparent mobility, which is related to the transmission in the linear regime. The saturated current is related to an injection velocity. The injection velocity is related to the transmission in the saturation regime. The transmission in the saturation regime is different, generally higher than the transmission in the linear regime. We also have a complete model that can fit IV characteristics of these transistors from small drain voltage to large drain voltage, from sub-threshold to above threshold. Okay. So the objective in this lecture is to show how we can use this model to experimentally characterize silicon MOSFETs, and we'll also look at some 3-5 FETs as well, because they operate in a different regime that is going to be interesting to us. So the example I'm going to use is a technology that was developed at IBM Research. They're called extremely thin silicon on insulator devices. There's a reference here for those of you that would like to read more about this technology. There are some critical numbers that we'll use in our analysis. These transistors are made on very thin silicon layers, only about 6 nanometers thick. The inversion layer capacitance has been measured. We believe we know what the appropriate effective mass is to you. We can therefore compute the unidirectional thermal velocity. The mobility can be measured in long channel devices, and we have a good handle on that. And as you'll see, we can deduce the mean free path for backscattering. It's about 16 nanometers, which is a little over a half of this channel length. So we expect these transistors to be operating in the quasi-ballistic regime. Now, I'm also going to be discussing a transistor called a 3-5 HEMT. 3-5 because it's made on a 3-5 semiconductor. 3-5 semiconductors generally display very high electron mobility, so we would expect them to operate closer to the ballistic limit. This has the same channel length as a silicon MOSFET, 30 nanometers. The device structure is a little different, and in the next unit, I'll explain what a HEMT is. It means high electron mobility transistor, but it is a field effect transistor, so our model should apply to it as well. There's a reference here that will give you more information about this particular device. The key difference is that we don't have an insulator between the gate and the channel. We have wide bandgap semiconductors. We modulate the gate charge with a reverse bias Schottky barrier junction, not with a MOS structure. But it's very similar in terms of its operation as a barrier controlled device. The channel itself is this region of indium arsenide. Indium arsenide in the bulk displays very high electron mobilities, and that's what makes transistors of interest like this. We call this a high mobility channel. That's why the device is called a high electron mobility transistor. Here are some numbers. The thickness of that thin indium arsenide layer is about 5 nanometers, comparable to the silicon thickness in the ETSOI transistor. We have measured inversion layer capacitance. The effective masses of indium arsenide is very light, which leads to a much higher unidirectional thermal velocity. And look at the long channel mobility, or the mobility in bulk indium arsenide. It's enormous compared to the electron mobility in silicon, almost 10 times as high as what you would get in silicon. We'll see that the mean free path that we deduce from this transistor is about 170 nanometers. It's only a 30 nanometer channel length transistor, so the mean free path is longer than the channel length. We would expect this device to be operating close to the ballistic limit. Okay. So how would we do an analysis? We might have a set of measured data. We would adjust the parameters in the virtual source model to provide the best fit to that experimental data. There are some certain parameters that need to be input to the model. So we have to input the channel length, so we have to know that. We have to have measured the inversion layer capacitance on a separate test structure, probably an MOS capacitor. And these two empirical parameters, alpha and beta, they don't vary much from transistor to transistor, but we have to input a reasonable value for each of those. Then the curve fitting process, and as you see, it's possible to fit the data very well. The curve fitting process then will produce some outputs, the best fit values for these parameters. The key outputs are the apparent mobility, the injection velocity. We also can fit and output the external parasitic series resistances that are inevitably there. And you can see the results that come out of the curve fitting on this particular device. All right, so let's look at the linear regime and see if we can understand a little bit about what's going on in this transistor. We know what the transmission is in the linear regime. We have the definition of the apparent mobility in the linear regime. We can work with these definitions of ballistic mobility and diffusive mobility, put them, combine them together in the apparent mobility, and we can conclude that the ratio of the apparent mobility that I would deduce from the fitting process to the ballistic mobility, which I'm able to compute, that ratio is the linear transmission. So we could use that to deduce what the transmission is in the linear regime. The apparent mobility was 220. The ballistic mobility we calculate, it's 658. The transmission is 0.33. So 1/3 of the electrons that are injected from the source in this 30 nanometer silicon MOSFET exit from the drain. Right? So our linear transmission is 33% and very easy to extract from a quick analysis just by taking the ratio of the apparent mobility to the ballistic mobility. Let's take a look at the saturation region of this transistor. We have an expression for the transmission in the saturated regime. We have an expression that relates that transmission to the injection velocity that we deduce from the fitting process. We can solve that expression for the transmission, and we get a simple relation. If we know the thermal injection velocity, which we can usually compute with reasonable accuracy, and we know the injection velocity, which we determine from the fitting process, then we can deduce what the transmission is. The injection velocity for this particular device is 1.14 times 10 to the 7th centimeters per second. The injection velocity deduced from the fitting process was 0.82 times 10 to the 7th. So if we deduce what the transmission is, it's 84%. All right, so relatively easy from the analysis then to estimate the transmission in the saturated regime. All right. Now, if we compare these two results, we'll see that the transmission in the saturated regime is significantly higher than the transmission in the linear regime. Even though the higher drain bias gives carriers more energy and they scatter more, as we've discussed, they scatter more in a region that it doesn't matter. Right? So this is a result that was as expected. We discussed the reasons for that earlier. It's because backscattering that occurs in the entire length of the channel can affect the transmission under low bias, but under high bias, if the electrons can zip across this very short bottleneck regime without scattering, then no matter how much they scatter in the high field drain region, they're going to come out the drain and will not lower the transmission. Okay, let's turn to the 3.5 data. So these are the virtual source fits to the 3.5 data. In this case, we deduce an apparent mobility that is 1800 centimeters squared per volt second. Remember that the bulk mobility of indium arsenide is enormously high. So this apparent mobility is almost an order of magnitude, roughly an order of magnitude lower than the bulk mobility. That's because of the ballistic mobility. The injection velocity that we deduce is far higher than the injection velocity that we deduced for the silicon MOSFET, about three times higher. And we can also get a handle on the series resistances. Okay, now if we take a look at some of this data and analyze it, we can estimate the transmission in the linear regime. To do that, we have to compute the ballistic mobility. So it's a little over 2,000. We put numbers in, and we can see that the transmission is over 80%. You know, for the silicon MOSFET, it was about 33%. So the transmission is far higher. That's because the mobility in indium arsenide is far higher than it is in silicon. In the saturated regime, the transmission should be even higher than 86%. And indeed, if we put numbers in, we find the transmission is 98%. So 3.5, modern 3.5 field effect transistors are really operating under high bias, and even under low bias, very close to the ballistic limit. So ballistic MOSFETs are not an academic exercise. Real devices operate close to the ballistic limit. So here's just a summary of how we would compare silicon versus 3.5. The major differences are that the mobility is significantly higher in 3.5 transistors. That leads to significantly higher transmission coefficients. 3.5 transistors operate near the ballistic limit. Silicon MOSFETs with comparable channel lengths operate not in the diffusive limit, but in this quasi-ballistic limit. They have a saturation transmission that is really even quite close to the ballistic limit itself. So both modern transistors operate far from this regime of conventional diffusive MOSFET theory. So there's a need to have a solid understanding of the physics, which is what we've been discussing in this course. Now, we could go a little bit more detail and do a little bit more extensive analysis. I'll just quickly indicate how people do that. You can take a look at a reference like this and see how it's done in more detail. But we have the apparent mobility. We have its definition. We have the ballistic mobility, which depends on channel length. We could put these two together, and we could see that if we were to characterize a series of transistors with different channel lengths and to extract the apparent mobility at each channel length, that if we were to plot 1 over the apparent mobility versus 1 over the channel length, then this should be a straight line. And from the y-intercept, we could deduce what the actual diffusion limit, scattering limited mobility is in this technology. And from the slope, we could deduce what the mean free path is. So that would require us to have a whole series of devices with different channel lengths. But here's some results. You can see that indeed, when you do this plot, it does fall in a straight line. From the intercept, we can deduce that the mobility in this 3.5 transistor is just about what you would expect the mobility to be in bulk indium arsenide due to the scattering. And we can deduce what the mean free path for backscattering is. And we can see that it is very long, longer than the channel length itself. Okay, now we could also do another analysis. We could look in the linear regime. And again, using our definitions of mobility and ballistic mobility, we could say that at any particular channel length, if we were interested in computing the mean free path at a particular channel length, we could take the apparent mobility that was extracted, to take the channel length which is known, we could put the two together, and we could extract the mean free path at that particular channel length. In order to do that, we would need to know the unidirectional thermal velocity. All right. This is a result of the analysis that is done. You can see this analysis was done for the extremely thin SOI devices. You can see that its mean free path is about 17 or 18 nanometers until the channel length gets short down around 30 nanometers, and then it drops a little bit. Okay, so it's not at all clear what's going on there. It's been argued that there are some fundamental physics that happen due to long-range Coulomb oscillations that occur when the source and the drain get very close, and that can happen at short channel lengths. That's a possibility. Other people have argued that there are some processing related issues that introduce defects in these very short channels that could be doing this. There's been some recent work thinking that, well, it might actually involve some backscattering occurring at the drain itself, and we've been assuming an ideal Landauer contact in which there is no backscattering at the drain. So there are some possibilities that aren't well understood yet, These are some issues that as people push to shorter and shorter channel lengths and different MOS structures, people are still trying to sort out. And if you want to see where that all stands right now, I can point you to this paper. Now, we can also do a little more thorough analysis of the saturation region of this device by recalling the definition of the transmission in saturation, how it is related to the injection velocity, which we deduced from the fitting process. We can therefore extract the transmission from those two parameters. We also, from the definition of the transmission then, we can relate the injection velocity to this critical length for backscattering. That would be an interesting quantity to understand. Exactly how long is this critical bottleneck regime in the device? Well, it's reasonable to assume, and some more sophisticated calculations bear this out, it's reasonable to assume that as I vary the channel length, that this bottleneck region is some fixed percentage of the channel length. As I go to a longer channel length, the bottleneck region becomes longer, but it's still the same percentage of the channel. Well, if I assume that it is some fraction of the channel length, then I could make a plot of 1 over the extracted injection velocity. It would be 1 over the thermal velocity plus a quantity that is proportional to the length of the channel. So I should get a straight line. Okay. If you do that plot, indeed you do get a straight line. And from that straight line, from the y-intercept of that straight line, you can deduce what the thermal injection velocity is. From the slope of that straight line, you can determine what fraction of the channel is the bottleneck. So what we deduce is what the thermal unidirectional thermal velocity is, and that's just about what we would expect from the known effective mass, square root of 2 kT over pi m. What we also deduce is that the bottleneck regime is about 10% of the channel length. So for this 30 nanometer channel length 3.5 hemp, there, the bottleneck is really quite short. It's about 3 nanometers near the source end of the channel. Those 3 nanometers are what limit the current. If an electron backscatters in those 3 nanometers, that's what limits the on current or the injection current. So that bottleneck regime is really quite short as we expected it to be. All right, so let's just summarize. This is an indication of how we can analyze experimental data. This MVS model, the MIT version of the virtual source model, provides us with a good way to extract key physical parameters. But, I remind you that the virtual source model refers to a well-designed transistor. It refers to a transistor in which the charge at the virtual source is maintained at its ideal value in a 1D MOS capacitor, C inversion, VG minus VT, with small corrections due to dibble. Unless the transistor has designed a transistor to do that with small dibble and small subthreshold slope, if the transistor is a bad transistor, you should not try to analyze it with this virtual source model. For more discussion about how you analyze experimental data, you can read a lot more about it in these two papers. Okay, what's next? So we are at the end of this unit almost. What I would like to do in the next lecture is just recap some of the key takeaways from Unit 4.